The following program is a production of HEW Entertainment and contains views, opinions, commentaries, and content that may offend some subscribers of this show. Listener discretion is advised.
People always ask me, Jonathan Clark, how do you become famous overnight? Okay, are you watching? This is how. You're over my head, I'm out of my mind, thinking I was wrong in the wrong time. It's like I'm rewind, everything is so throwbacky. So, what did you think? Hey guys, it's Jonathan Clark, and I don't know if it's anything to do with how I'm a really big fan of Legends, but I am so in shock over all these retirements we have seen so early on in 2019. Retirements of not just Kurt Angle, which I was expecting to happen sometime between now and the halfway point of the year, but also Dave Bautista and Dean Ambrose have also said goodbye to WWE and their careers and all the fans who have supported them and stood by them for what feels like forever. I was a huge Kurt Angle fan back in the early 90s, late 2000s, especially when Kurt Angle went through this metamorphical period where he metamorphosized himself into a wrestling phenomenon, which there was no doubt in anyone's mind, at least in this era of professional wrestling, that he was. I know that John Layfield comments on Kurt Angle by saying that Kurt Angle is believed in his mind to have been one of the greatest athletes of all time and the greatest wrestler of all time, which I concur with JBL on thinking, because I really believe that Kurt Angle was a Shawn Michaels, a Bret Hart, a Stone Cold Steve Austin, a Triple H, all rolled into one, even a Hulk Hogan, if you want to go that far. I think that Kurt Angle is going to be missed. I appreciate how WWE handled his farewell tour, although I don't really agree with some of the things that they did, some of the opponents they gave him. Without a doubt, his best opponent that he had and challenge came from AJ Styles, who I'm really happy has moved over from SmackDown Live to Monday Night Raw now, on the show that he's been deserving of being on ever since his WWE debut and his days spent in TNA Wrestling. It's been a long time coming for AJ Styles, and he's in a place now where he belongs, and I hope they keep him over on Monday Night Raw. But the best opponent Kurt Angle had was AJ Styles during this whole farewell tour. The feud with Baron Corbin made no sense to me at all, and if you were going to say goodbye to Kurt Angle, you would have thought they would have put him in the ring against someone like a Universal Champion like Seth Rollins or Brock Lesnar, which is what I was hoping was going to happen for Kurt Angle. One last time, Kurt Angle and Brock Lesnar. If you can go one last time, Undertaker and Brock Lesnar, you can go one last time, Kurt Angle and Brock Lesnar. He could have had more formidable opponents than what he did. I think there was a lack of respect coming from WWE, especially that of Triple H and Stephanie and Vince, because I think that, you know, Kurt Angle is one of the most respected individuals of all time and should remain known as one of the most respected individuals of all time. So, you know, there were some things that I agreed with and others that I didn't with how they handled Kurt Angle's retirement in 2019. The farewell tour was done good because there were a lot of venues and a lot of places the tour stopped on the road to WrestleMania. His final match, of course, was at WrestleMania 35. That was to be expected, but it could have been handled a lot better than what it was. I appreciate it so much, but in other ways, in a lot of ways, I didn't appreciate how they disrespected Kurt Angle. And maybe that has a lot to do with how I'm a really big fan of Kurt Angle and everything he's accomplished, having done everything he's been eligible to do, and every championship having held it that he's been eligible to compete for, everything from the European title back in the day, right through to the WWE World Heavyweight Championship in 2006 at WrestleMania 22. That phenomenal triple threat match with Rey Mysterio, Randy Orton, and Kurt Angle is a pure illustration of just how good Kurt Angle is at everything he's done over the last 20-plus years of professional wrestling. And Dean Ambrose retiring, I didn't expect that to happen. I know that Dean Ambrose has been battling a lot of both personal and professional issues. He's had a number of injuries that he's had to battle back from. That injury a couple of months ago was one that was highly documented. I know that Renee Young obviously has to be feeling very emotional and mixed emotions about Dean Ambrose's retirement. I really thought they were really going to run full throttle with the Shield reuniting, but obviously with the Shield going farewell their farewell tour and the final time we were going to get the chance to see the Shield team up. That had everything to do with them knowing that Dean Ambrose's retirement and his final match was coming. How they handled Dean Ambrose's retirement, something else that I didn't agree with, because Dean Ambrose by 2016 became one of the most popular WWE superstars and was well on his way to becoming the most popular athlete out of the Shield to really have a successful singles career. He's a former WWE champion, and yes, you can compare, you can say there's no comparison with the popularity of Seth Rollins and Roman Reigns, maybe now, to the popularity of Dean Ambrose, but 3 years ago, there was no doubt in my mind or anyone else's mind that Dean Ambrose was well on his way to becoming the most popular athlete out of the threesome known as the Shield. Now there's really no comparison, but I think they really lost the sense of direction with Dean Ambrose's character. There was a lot of confusion with Dean Ambrose's character being known as the Lunatic Fringe, so they kind of just killed him off in a match with Bobby Lashley. Bobby Lashley puts him through the announcer table right next to Renee Young, of course, his real-life wife. Who I know both personally and professionally. I've worked with her over the years, giving her numbers and connections to WWE. But, you know, I think they could have handled Dean Ambrose's retirement a lot better than what they did, give him a more formidable opponent, like I just said about Kurt Angle. It's just like WWE have a lot of pent-up aggression and emotion towards these wrestlers they want to hold on to. And obviously, Dean Ambrose was somebody they wanted to hold on to. So I think they could have given him a more formidable opponent. They could have had him go out on top. If they didn't want him to go out as WWE Universal or WWE Champion, they could have given him a better opponent, and they could have, you know, gave us something to remember Dean Ambrose by, not just by being put through a table by Bobby Lashley and Leo Rush adding insult to injury. That was very unprofessional, and Dean Ambrose is someone who I think is really going to be missed by WWE. Dave Batista's retirement, that was something else that caught me off guard. I really thought that Dave Batista was coming back at least for a few months. With WWE, this is the one retirement that I don't think we have seen the last of. I refuse to believe that we have seen the last of Dave Batista in WWE, and I think we're going to see him have more opponents because I've always said that Dave Batista versus Brock Lesnar is a pay-per-view match waiting to happen. It hasn't happened since it was put in the minds of wrestling fans in 2005. And I remember the 2005 SummerSlam press conference that year, Shawn Michaels and Hulk Hogan headlined the extravaganza. Dave Batista said when he was posed the question that Brock Lesnar versus Dave Batista, a few years after Brock Lesnar left from the first half of his WWE career, that Dave Batista versus Brock Lesnar was a pay-per-view waiting to happen, and Brock Lesnar had to get his ass back to WWE. Now that Brock Lesnar has gone elsewhere with his career, at least for the time being, and he's still under contract with WWE, I think that when Brock Lesnar returns, that challenge is going to come either from Paul Heyman or Brock Lesnar, and hopefully we will see Dave Batista not just make a return, but that match between Dave Batista and Brock Lesnar will happen. After his match with Triple H, his emphatic loss to Triple H at WrestleMania, which Triple H seems to be able to get away with nowadays, having himself win over people like Sting in 2015 and now Dave Batista in 2019, and before that, The Undertaker, just last year at the Super Showdown in Melbourne, Australia. It seems like Triple H gets away with putting himself over against individuals who he's failed to defeat previously in earlier stages of his career. He did it with The Undertaker, he did it with Sting, now he's done it with Batista, and then Batista shocks the world by announcing his retirement from professional wrestling, which obviously I think he can get away with saying upset a lot of people. And I can understand why, because Dave Batista is an extremely popular wrestler. I talk to people all the time who say they are a really big fan of Dave Batista, and I can understand why. There are people who even have email addresses dedicated to how much of a fan they are of Dave Batista. I talked to one individual who appeared on my show a number of times on the podcast who was a really big fan of Dave Batista. He hosted a number of shows with me before he went elsewhere with his life choices. And he's not the only one. There are so many people who love Dave Batista. Dave Batista sold a lot of merchandise. He put asses in seats in 2004, 2005, when himself and John Cena were upstart talents in WWE coming over from OVW like Brock Lesnar did and Randy Orton did. They were people who put asses in seats. So I refuse to believe that WWE are just going to let Dave Batista go. Triple H and Stephanie McMahon have done everything to try to keep Dave Batista happy. And they always say this is the excuse because of the crowd reactions not being where Batista wanted them, because of the responses he was getting, because of the main events he was being put in, the opponents, the challenges he was given, because he didn't get that Brock Lesnar match, because he didn't get many multiple reigns as champion. He left. I think there is a lot of confusion with Dave Bautista's character, just as there was for Dean Ambrose. And I think that once those kinks are kind of ironed out, we will see people like Dean Ambrose and Dave Bautista back, because I refuse to believe that we have seen the last of Dave Bautista. We've probably seen the last of Dean Ambrose ever before we've seen the last of Dave Bautista, but it seems like he's just brought back for these reunions or these special shows because he wants to be an actor, which has been documented. He said that he wants to be an actor, but even though he says that he wants to be an actor, I refuse to believe that this is what we have seen from Dave Bautista. A loss to Triple H, and that's it. You better believe he didn't sign a contract just to come back to lose to Triple H after having three previous victories over Triple H from 2004 to 2005, especially in 2005 with that unbelievable Hell in a Cell match, which I just watched the other day, with the huge wrestling video collection that I have. It just doesn't make sense to me. A lot of this doesn't really. But the good thing about it is the door of opportunity is more widely open now, especially in the fallout of the 2019 Superstar Shakeup, which we're coming up on night two, actually tonight, of SmackDown Live in Montreal. Going to be looking forward to seeing what superstars come over from Raw to SmackDown Live. Really proud of the fact that AJ Styles now has made his way to Monday Night Raw. And we have a shakeup now that actually is going to be remembered. I actually came away from this year's shakeup actually pleased, at least the Raw half of it. I haven't seen the SmackDown half of it yet because it hasn't happened. But when I read the results on WWE.com this morning, was really happy to see some of the trades that were made, and hopefully this will benefit fans, the storylines will be better, and we'll see things like Lacey Evans getting an opportunity, which has been a long time coming for her, and we'll see AJ Styles getting an opportunity at Seth Rollins in that WWE Universal Championship, which could be a match happening by at least Backlash or SummerSlam. Seth Rollins versus AJ Styles is another pay-per-view waiting to happen, and I think I can get away with saying that. And more opportunities are going to be coming the way of people like Lyra Sullivan, Lacey Evans, who I just mentioned, the new women's tag team champions, the Iconics, who are now a part of Monday Night Raw and SmackDown Live because they have the titles that are exclusive to both shows, and this winner-take-all scenario, which could be coming into fruition for the tag team and WWE championships in due time, if not by Backlash, by SummerSlam. Really looking forward to finding out what's going to be happening, and even more so now that SummerSlam is going to be in Toronto, the first international SummerSlam in at least 15 years. It's been since 2004. So there's a lot happening, and there's a lot to be excited about. But these retirements, some of them I accept, some of them not so much. But we'll see what direction we're headed in. The good thing is the door of opportunity is more widely open now, and there isn't a better time to be a wrestling fan than now, so take advantage of it. If you're not following WWE, get over to WWE.com, get on social media, follow all the happenings, because 2019 is going to be a really big year as we kick off the 2019 WWE season in the fallout of one of the most incredible WrestleManias, which I didn't foresee it being, but it surprised me in a lot of ways, especially with how women really exceeded the expectations of all the critics out there. All the sports news websites and entertainment news websites are talking about it. It's all over our news feed on our website, so make sure you get in on all the conversation happening. Until I stream another video for you on my YouTube channel, I am once again your host, Jonathan Clark. Really proud to be a part of 2019, and I will see you again really soon. So long for now.
HEW Entertainment Radio is a production of HEW Entertainment on their official website and broadcasts on social media. You can join the conversation on our Facebook page at HEW Entertainment, follow and listen to our show on Twitter at JonathanClark1, and watch us on our YouTube channel at JonathanClark22. Hosted and produced by Jonathan Clark out of Canada, if you have any questions on our radio broadcast, you can email us at JonathanClark2005@hotmail.com. Thank you for listening.